You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about the breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Pakistan initiates fresh cross-border shelling to facilitate infiltration. FATF sends new set of questions to Pakistan, seeks more clarification on actions taken against terror funding. 15 security personnel killed as Taliban insurgents attack security checkpoint in bulk. And Jaish-e-Mohammed planning to attack India's sacred city, Ayodhya. Pakistan has run amok ever since Indian administration abrogated Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir, enabling the Indian state to receive direct benefits from the centre. It has intensified its efforts at increasing the strengths of terrorists along the line of control. It is constantly trying to infiltrate terrorists through ceasefire violations in Kashmir. However, all its attempts have been foiled by Indian security forces. Recently, Indian security forces successfully busted a terror module of terrorist group Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Toyba operating in Kashmir, a report. The Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir continues to remain tense as Indo-Pak line of control is constantly being targeted by Pakistan Army. Continuing with its malicious agenda, Pakistan recently launched unprovoked rounds of ceasefire violations by firing artillery guns and intense shelling with mortars along the LOC in Rampur and Uri sector of Jammu and Kashmir. The Indian Army strongly retaliated against these ceasefire violations, resulting in heavy exchange of fire that claimed the lives of an Indian junior commissioned officer and one civilian. Having lost a soldier and civilian in the firing, Indian Army inflicted heavy damage to Pakistani troops, failing their latest attempts of facilitating terrorist infiltration.
Pakistan ki taraf se wahan par ghuspaith ki bahut sari koshishein ho rahi hain. और मिलिटेंट्स को टेररिस्ट को वो लाते हैं वहाँ पर लाइन ऑफ कंट्रोल के पास लॉन्चिंग पैड्स के पास वहाँ से सीजफायर वायलेशंस हो रही हैं सिविलियन साइड पे भी नुकसान होता है आर्मी की साइड पे भी कुछ नुकसान हुआ है तो इस तरह की जो हरकतें वहाँ पर होती हैं उनका मुंह तोड़ जवाब दिया जा रहा है हमारी तरफ से हमारी जो बॉर्डर गार्डिंग फोर्सेज हैं उनकी तरफ से और हालात बिल्कुल काबू में है मगर ये बात सही है कि वहाँ पर पाकिस्तान आर्मी की तरफ से बहुत सारी कोशिशें होती हैं जिसमें टेररिस्ट को इस तरफ भेजने के लिए और साथ-साथ सीज़फ़ायर वायलेशन करते हैं वहाँ।
स्क्रैपिंग ऑफ द टेंपरेरी स्पेशल स्टेटस ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर हैज बैडली रैटल्ड पाकिस्तान व्हिच इज डेस्परेटली कैरिंग आउट सीज़फ़ायर वायलेशंस टू इन्फिल्ट्रेट टेररिस्ट्स थ्रू जम्मू एंड कश्मीर इन ऑर्डर टू क्रिएट अनरेस्ट इन द वैली Recently, Jammu and Kashmir police busted a module of terrorist associates hailing from Pakistan in Thral and Sopore areas of Kashmir who were involved in providing logistic support to the Pakistan-based terror group Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Toyba.
त्राल के एरिया में एक आतंकी पकड़ा गया जो बड़ी देर से जैश मोहम्मद के साथ काम कर रहा था वहाँ का एक उमर भाई करके पाकिस्तान का जैश मोहम्मद का कमांडर है उसका ये साथी था और कल इसको त्राल के एरिया में वंतीपुर जिला में पकड़ा है इसके साथ ही सजाद हैदर करके एक लश्कर तौबा का कमांडर है जो सोपोर की बेल्ट में काम करता है उसका एक साथी भी कल पकड़ा गया है और उसके पकड़े जाने के बाद उसका पूरा मॉड्यूल जो था इनका तीन चार लड़के जो इनके साथ बतौर टेररिस्ट एसोसिएट और टेररिज्म में हिस्सा ले रहे थे उस तरह का काम कर रहे थे
पाकिस्तान ऑक्यूपाइड कश्मीर हैज बिकम द हब ऑफ टेरर लॉन्च पैड्स टेररिस्ट इन दीज लॉन्च पैड्स आर ऑलवेज ऑन अ लुकआउट टू इन्फिल्ट्रेट इनटू कश्मीर व्हिच इज फैसिलिटेटेड बाय सच कांस्टेंट अनप्रोवोक्ड सीज़फ़ायर वायलेशंस बाय पाकिस्तान आर्मी However, Indian security forces are effectively thwarting these infiltration bits. Financial Action Task Force has sought more clarifications and data from Pakistan on actions taken by it against madrasas belonging to banned outfits, weeks after Islamabad submitted a report to the Paris-based body detailing steps taken by the country to curb terrorism and money laundering.
The Financial Action Task Force, or FATF, has sent 150 questions to Pakistan seeking clarifications, updates and actions taken against the madrasas belonging to proscribed outfits. According to Pakistani media reports, FATF raised the set of questions in an email weeks after Islamabad submitted a compliance report on December 6.
When last Pakistan gave its report, it out of 23 parameters, it just was able to complete only 3 parameters. But still, with the help of China, it managed to get an extension. Now what the FATF has done is, they have given Pakistan 150 questions, because the terror funding is not only being done by the government agencies, but also the various organizations being run by these terrorists. Now, it is going to be very difficult for Pakistan to wriggle out of this, because all these 150 questions pertain to most of the organizations, so-called social organizations, charity organizations being run by these militant groups.
To fix serious weaknesses in its anti-money laundering.
FATF's latest notice to Pakistan signals trouble for the country, as officials report that Jamaat-ud-Dawah's network includes 300 seminaries and schools. The Jamaat-ud-Dawah, or GUD, is run by Hafiz Saeed, the Mumbai attack mastermind. At least 56 madrasas and facilities are also being run under the GUD and Falai Insaniyat Foundation in southern Sindh province.
Just Jamaat-ul-Dawah is running more than 300 seminaries and so many madrasas over there. In these madrasas, what is being taught to the children is total jihad, total war against all infidels in the world. So it is now going to be very difficult for Pakistan to really explain as to how they are allowing all this to happen right under their noses, because now the cat is out of the bag. Entire world knows that Pakistan is the hub of terrorism, and Pakistan, all these organizations, that the militant organizations that are being run, that are stationed there, that are being protected by the ISI and the Pakistan Army, are all in Pakistan.
At present, FATF's inquiry on terror-related entities in Pakistan holds immense significance, because the country is running proceedings on Lashkar-e-Taiba leader Hafiz Saeed on terror funding charges in an anti-terrorism court in Pakistan's eastern city of Lahore. As informed by legal sources, Hafiz Saeed pleaded not guilty in the second case, which is related to Saeed's pseudo-charity activities that are actually running for collecting illegal funds to finance his terror enterprises. Saeed was indicted on similar charges in another case on December 11.
Whenever Hafiz Saeed's cases come up there, the evidence is not produced before the judge. Now, if there is no evidence before the judge will not convict him, because judiciary sees evidence on record what is there. Now, this game Pakistan is playing just to try to protect Hafiz Saeed, because Hafiz Saeed is one of their child, ISI's progeny, who is trained to create mayhem all over the world by sending in his jihadists and his suicide bombers.
The indictments come ahead of a meeting of World Financial Watchdog Financial Action Task Force in February 2020 that will decide whether to blacklist Pakistan for its failure to curb terror financing. If blacklisted, then Pakistan would most certainly face major financial crisis, as the International Monetary Funding, or IMF, recently informed that blacklisting of Pakistan by the FATF could have serious implications for capital inflows to the country. The Global Terror Financing Watchdog had in October this year kept Pakistan on the grey list for an extended period till February 2020.
As Pakistan's efforts to destabilize India through its devious conspiracies have failed completely, it is now planning to hamstring Indian missions in Afghanistan. A recent intelligence report of Indian security agencies have revealed that Pakistan's ISI is forging a partnership between Lashkar-e-Toyba and Islamic State to carry out suicide bomb attacks on Indian embassy and India's other infrastructure projects in Afghanistan, a report.
In a massive revelation, Indian security agencies have warned New Delhi of a possible attack on Indian missions in Afghanistan. Pakistani establishment in cahoots with world's deadliest terrorist organizations, Lashkar-e-Taiba and Islamic State, is planning to attack Indian embassy and multiple development undertakings of New Delhi in Afghanistan. As per the Intel report, Pakistan's ISI is facilitating partnership between Lashkar-e-Taiba and Islamic State to carry out car bomb suicide attacks.
See, the Indian presence in Afghanistan does not suit Pakistan at all. Pakistan considers against its national interest if there is Indian presence in Afghanistan. Pakistan wants zero-sum game as far as India's presence in Pakistan is concerned, and Pakistan wants total control over Afghanistan's affairs so that it can use it strategically. For that, Pakistan has always been eyeing the Indian mission and other Indian infrastructure in Afghanistan. Even in 2008, about 40 people died in a deadly car bomb attack outside the Indian embassy in Kabul. Thereafter, in 2013, the Indian consulate at Jalalabad was targeted, and in that, the hand of Lashkar-e-Taiba was also found to be involved. Similarly, there have been many other attempts, and now what Pakistan is doing is that it is using LET and Islamic State.
As per the report, a dedicated team led by a person named Saifullah is coordinating between the two sides. Islamabad is providing every man and material assistance required in this coordination. Inputs suggest that five suicide bombers have received training to launch the suicide bombing. This, however, isn't a new challenge to New Delhi, as Pakistan has been perennially using its eastern border to launch attacks against India. The vigilant Indian forces have resisted and crushed all its nefarious designs, following which the defeated army generals have resorted to hurting it in other countries.
It is a desperation on part of Pakistan, because Pakistan has been unable to carry out any terrorist attack in other than Kashmir and other parts of India ever since 2014. And Pakistan has tried desperately. Pakistan has tried through its agents, its affiliates, through other organizations. It even tried through Al-Qaeda, but it's failed. Now it is using the IS, Islamic State in Afghanistan, Pakistan, to target the Indian mission with the help of Lashkar-e-Taiba. And with so much of Indian diaspora spread all over the world, it's always been a cause of concern that the jihadi terrorists may target them. And with this input, it's likely that ISI may use the jihadi terrorist outfits other than Afghanistan also to target Indian diaspora and Indian targets.
Preventing India from gaining significant footholds in Afghanistan has always been Pakistan's top priority. It assumes that India's deep presence in Afghanistan can hamper its devious nexus with the terrorists. To gain a strategic depth in this war-torn country with porous borders has been Islamabad's another agenda. For that, it regularly hires, nurtures, and finances the terrorists and mercenaries. However, to its disappointment, none of its agendas have borne fruit owing to competent security forces of India.
Security checkpoints in Afghanistan remain under attack by Taliban fighters. Recently, A government checkpoint in Balk province of Afghanistan was attacked by the insurgents, where they killed 15 members of the Afghan security forces. The attack came just few days following the killing of a U.S. service member in the country, a report. Taliban insurgents ambushed a government checkpoint in Balk province in Afghanistan's north, killing at least 15 members of the security forces, the latest in an escalating series of insurgent attacks. More than 18 years after U.S.-led forces toppled the hardline Taliban regime, Afghan forces are suffering record casualties with Afghanistan and U.S. officials warning that the toll is not sustainable. Despite a winter lull in fighting due to heavy snowfall in the mountains, where the Islamist Taliban typically rest and regroup ahead of their annual spring offensive, assaults on vulnerable security checkpoints continue across the country.
They are carrying out these attacks basically to send out a message that their power is increasing, their influence is growing, and the government that is in Kabul is a puppet government that has been supported by foreign forces, and they should move out and Taliban should assume the reins of power. So they are working towards that, and this is their way of sending out a message that they have full control, they have full authority.
Earlier in the same week, Taliban fighters killed a U.S. service member in Afghanistan during a counter-terrorism operation in the Kunduz province. The U.S. Defense Department informed Michael Gubel, a U.S. Army sergeant from New Jersey, died from injuries sustained while his unit was engaged in combat operations. Zabiullah Mujahid, a spokesman for the Taliban, claimed responsibility for the killing as he asserted that the U.S. force member was killed in a blast in the northern province of Kunduz.
Irrespective of wherever, how far these places might be, but they can never presume that they are safe. And Taliban has been relentlessly carrying out these attacks, and they have been very successful. Whether it is the American troops or the NATO forces or the international security forces or even the Afghan national security forces.
The Taliban insurgency remains resilient even two decades after US-led forces toppled its regime that led to the United States' longest war. In September, the US and the Taliban had appeared on the verge of signing a deal aimed at reducing America's military footprint in the country. But later, the US President Donald Trump abruptly broke off the diplomatic engagement with the Taliban after a particularly deadly spate of violence broke out in Kabul, in which 12 people were killed, including a US soldier. The talk remains halted for over 2 months until the US President, in a recent surprise visit to Afghanistan, informed about the resumed peace talks between the concerned parties. Later, U.S. Special Envoy Zelmay Khalilzad also arrived in Kabul on December 4th in a bid to breathe new life into efforts to end the war in Afghanistan. But the resumed talks seem to have a short life since following a suicide attack on a U.S. base outside Kabul, Zelmay Khalilzad announced about a brief pause from talks between the Taliban and the U.S. negotiators. Pakistan-based Jaish-e-Mohammed terror group is planning to launch a major attack on India's sacred city of Ayodhya in eastern Uttar Pradesh state. Indian intelligence sources revealed the inputs about a planned attack this week that also marks the 20th anniversary of Kandahar attack in 1999.
Jaish-e-Mohammed, the perpetrator of Pulwama terror attack, is once again planning to unleash bloodshed in India. Credible sources reveal that Indian intelligence agencies recently intercepted a message of Jaish-e-Mohammed or JEM chief Maulana Masood Azhar, in which he talked about executing an attack on the Ram Janmabhoomi temple site in Ayodhya. Azhar, who is also a UN designated terrorist, is said to have shared the message through a social media app that is being used by the terror group since long for establishing connections with JEM stakeholders in Lahore.
should they ever succeed in planning an attack and carrying out an attack at Ram Janmabhoomi, the payoffs to the Pakistanis would be optimal. There will be media coverage across the globe. Possibly there will be riots between Hindus and Muslims, and that's what Pakistan is wanting.
Jaish-e-Muhammad has carried out several high-profile suicide and other attacks against Indian targets since its formation. In 2001, JEM carried out attacks on the Legislative Assembly building in Jammu and Kashmir and on the Indian Parliament, and more than 50 people were killed in the two attacks. At present, Masood is receiving medical aid in a military hospital of Pakistan, while his group is working actively in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir to train and launch terrorists from JEM's training camps.
Jaish-e-Muhammad and Masood Azhar want to give maximum payoffs and dividends to their handlers in Pakistan. Otherwise, his importance will get degraded by an order of magnitude.
Azhar founded Jaish-e-Muhammad after he was released from Indian custody in 1999 in exchange for more than 150 hostages held on IC-814 Indian Airlines, which had been hijacked and diverted to Kandahar in Afghanistan. Masood was arrested from Kashmir in 1994 and holds immense importance for Pakistan's notorious Inter-Services Intelligence Agency, or ISI. In order to get him released from Indian custody, the Kandahar hijack was planned by the Pakistan's ISI after several failed attempts of Masood's release through official and unofficial channels. According to the United Nations, Azhar is said to have formed JEM with the support of then Al-Qaeda chief Osama bin Laden and the Afghan Taliban.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@aniin.com. This is Surbhi Sharma, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching Tag.